Welcome you all to VTUE Sikshana program. I'll be teaching you 18 EC63 Microwaves and Antennas Module 1. I am Dr. K. Srilakshmi from RV College of Engineering. Right? Today let us look at what are the contents of lecture 5. So in the previous lectures, in this module, as you all know, that we have two portions, microwave tubes and microwave transmission lines. So in microwave tubes, in lecture 1 and 2, we have seen what is the conventional vacuum tube, what are their limitations and why they are not suitable for microwave frequencies. In the second lecture, we have seen the construction and working of reflex klystron oscillator. In the third lecture, we came to microwave transmission lines and we saw microwave frequencies and their bands and their utilities. In the fourth lecture, we looked at transmission line equations and their solutions. Today in lecture number 5, let us look at the reflection coefficient, transmission coefficient and standing wave ratio, which are the parameters, which are important parameters that we measure on the transmission line for its design and utility. Right? So let us look at one by one. See, so far we have seen the basic transmission line, two-wire transmission line structure. We have seen with one end as the sending end, the other one as the receiving end, okay, or the load end. And ZL is the load impedance. So VG will be the sending end generator voltage. ZG will be the sending end generator impedance. Then you have the transmitted voltage VT, and also let us consider a small length of the line L, and V plus and V minus are voltages at the sending end and receiving end respectively. So this results in a I plus current, and there is a reflected current I minus due to the mismatch in the characteristic impedance of the line Z naught and the load impedance ZL. Fine. We are going to see more on this when we look at the impedance matching. Right now, you understand or consider that whenever the characteristic impedance of the line is not equal to the load impedance on the other end of the line, there will be some portion of the voltage will be reflected back, which is traveling back as the backward wave. In the previous discussion on transmission line solutions, we have seen there are two types of waves on the transmission line at any point, isn't it? One is the forward traveling wave and then other one is the backward traveling wave. So we didn't know at that time what was the reason for backward traveling wave and where it originated from. Now I am telling you, the origin of the backward traveling wave is due to the reflection. And why reflection comes in? Because of the mismatch between Z naught and ZL. Fine. So right now we'll keep it at that. Next, when we look at the impedance matching and usage of Smith chart, we'll take up more in details on that. Fine. So now in the solution to transmission line equations, we have seen that there will be a reflected wave. Okay. So if the two impedances are equal, then there will be no reflected wave. Such a line is called as a flat line, okay, or a pure line. Okay, now let us modify the equations which are in terms of Z, the distance parameter, by putting Z equal to L, because here we are considering the length of the line to be L, right? So the Z, the distance parameter, now we are putting it as equal to L. So then now the equations are in terms of L, and when we put Z equal to L, we are writing the equations at the load end of the line, right? We are measuring Z from the source end. So when Z equal to L, where are we? We are standing at the load end, fine? So we are writing the equations at the load end. So these are the equations. I'll not explain much about this. You all know about these equations. So when we take up the ratio of VL by IL, you get ZL. That also we know. This is the basic Ohm's law. And this is the impedance equation of the line at the load end, fine? Now, coming to reflection coefficient, I said this is one of the important parameters of measurement on the transmission line. What is a reflection coefficient? See, there are two things for this reflection coefficient. It is always measured at a point on the line. Why? Because since it is dependent on the voltage on the line, we all know that voltage at every point is changing. Okay, it changes with respect to distance, it changes with respect to time, both. So that we have seen. So reflection coefficient cannot be same on the line at every point. It is a value which varies from 0 to 1. Its minimum value is 0 and maximum value is 1. So when will it be 0? When there are no reflections on the line. When there are no reflections on the line, when Z naught equal to ZL. Okay, on a flat line, the reflection coefficient value will be equal to 0. And on a highly mismatched line, that Z naught is far, far away from ZL in value, then in that case, majority of the incident voltage gets reflected back, which is a bad condition on the line that we are going to discuss. So, in this case, the incident voltage is almost equal to the reflected voltage, then the ratio will be equal to 1, which is a highly lossy line or highly mismatched line. Okay. Now, the definition for reflection coefficient is that it is a ratio of what? The reflected voltage or current divided by incident voltage or current. So, when you see this definition, you see that reflection coefficient can be in terms of voltage. It can be voltage reflection coefficient or current reflection coefficient. And you all know at every point on the line, the voltage is a complex value which has a real number as well as an imaginary part. So, since the ratio is of two voltages, again, reflection coefficient is a complex quantity. It will have a magnitude as well as a phase angle theta L. Okay, this is magnitude. Tau L within these two straight lines is magnitude. Okay, magnitude of the reflection coefficient. You all know that this is the polar form of a complex variable. Okay, you can express the complex number in terms of a polar form as well as rectangular form. If you write it as x plus jy, let us say, then it is called rectangular form. If you write it as tau L magnitude into e raised to the power of j theta L, then it is in the polar form. Okay, theta L is the phase angle. And in terms of reflection, the reflection coefficient in terms of the impedances is ZL minus Z0 divided by ZL plus Z0. Okay. So, please remember all these formulae. They will be helpful in solving small problems. Okay. So, you may have to design the transmission line, in which case you may have to estimate the reflection coefficient given the impedance values. Right. So, in such cases, you can use this expression. Fine. So, you know that ZL and Z0 are also complex quantities on a general transmission line. Unless it is a lossless line, sorry. So, Z0 equal to root of L by C that we have seen for a lossless transmission line, which in case will be just a real number. It is not a complex value. But ZL in general will be always a complex value unless it is a pure resistance. Okay. So, we have seen what is reflection coefficient. Let us move on to the next term. Transmission coefficient. Okay, so now we have a general transmission line. Remember the same diagram what I showed you in the previous slide. So terminated with Z0 characteristic impedance line terminated with ZL. Okay, when they are not equal, some portion of the power gets reflected back. This we have seen. Now what happens to the remaining power? It has to get into the load, isn't it? So it should get transmitted into the load. According to the principle of conservation of energy, no energy is lost or created. So, since some energy is incident on the line, part of it is coming back, the remaining part should go forward into the load. How much of it is going forward into the load is called as or is measured in terms of transmission coefficient. Fine. So, the reflected power must be equal to the transmitted power plus the incident. it can be written as 1 minus tau L square mathematically. So if you do some mathematical manipulations, tau L, you know it is ZL minus Z0 divided by ZL plus Z0. So if you substitute that and if you do the manipulations, you get Z0 by ZL into T square, where T is the transmission coefficient. Okay. So T is actually equal to 2ZL by ZL plus Z0. And what is the definition of T? It is transmitted voltage or current divided by incident voltage or current. And this has to be definitely at what point? It has to be at the load point. Okay. So V transmitted by V incident or I transmitted by I incident. So we use in the design more of reflection coefficient than of transmission coefficient, because this amount of power anyway has reached the load. We need not bother about it. We should be only bothered to reduce the amount of reflections. So generally in the design, we will be more bothered and more concentrating on the reflection coefficient than on the transmission coefficients. Okay, nonetheless, we need to know this as a parameter. So here we are. Fine. So now we have seen what is reflection coefficient and what is transmission coefficient. Let us move on to a simple example. This example is given even in the book. Okay, you can see that given a transmission line with some Z0 value and is terminated in some load impedance, you can calculate both reflection coefficient as well as transmission coefficients. Fine, you just see this. So you get it in the, when you substitute these two things and then you solve them, you get it in the form of a rectangular value, which you can convert it into a polar form. Both of them are complex numbers. I hope you all know how to manipulate complex numbers using your calculator. Fine. So I have also given some simple formulae at the end of the next presentation. So you can use them as well. Now come to the third value, which is also related in a way to the transmission reflection coefficient and is a very, very important parameter for the design. Fine. This is called as standing wave ratio. Before we go into standing wave ratio, these terms are new to us. Standing wave, we know what is a traveling wave, what is a reflected wave, isn't it? Then what is the standing wave? Let us see what is the standing wave. Fine. So you know that on any point on the transmission line, there are two waves. One going in the positive Z direction, other coming back in the negative Z direction. So if you measure the effective voltage at every point on the line, it is an algebraic sum of the incident as well as reflected value. Why did I say it as algebraic sum? Because one is going in one phase, other one is coming in the opposite phase, PHASE, right? So we don't know at what phase the line voltages are, okay? When we take the algebraic sum, there may be some points wherein the voltages are in the same phase, okay? Because they are alternating, no? They keep changing. By some chance, they are in the same phase. At that point, they add together. And then what will be the effective voltage? It will be more than actually the incident voltage. Why? Because to the incident voltage, some portion of reflected voltage is also getting added up. So then at some other points, they may be actually equal in value, magnitude, but just opposite in phase, 180 degrees. What will happen to their algebraic value? They cancel each other and the value becomes zero. Okay. Next, there may be some points wherein both are in the negative going phase, but in the same phase, but negative. So again, they add up, but in the negative way. So you have a negative peak as well as a positive peak. Okay. So you have zero in between. So this pattern of maximum, minimum, and the minimum touching zero sometimes, this is called as standing waves. Okay. Why It is called as a standing wave. See, none of the signals, the reflected voltage or the transmitted voltage, they are not stationary, isn't it? They are moving on the line. Then how come their algebraic sum is standing still? It is not standing still. The pattern that is resulting from the interaction between the transmitted wave and the reflected wave, it seems to be constant on the line. Okay, there is continuous movement because of which there is interaction, and because of the interaction the pattern is formed, and the pattern remains constant on the line, because of which the name standing wave. Understood? So standing wave, again I repeat, results in the interaction between the transmitted wave and the reflected wave. Fine. Now look at this. We can actually formulate an voltage expression for the standing wave voltage. Okay, because we know the transmitted voltage part and we also know the reflected voltage part, and we assume that both are real. At some point the voltage equation becomes so much, which is again a complex value, and you have the magnitude of which given by this equation. Fine. Now see, this is the standing wave pattern what I was talking of. See, this is the place where the voltages are adding up and forming a maximum value, and this is the place where the voltages are cancelling and then coming into a minimum value. So on a lossless line you have this kind of a pattern, and then it is repeating. Okay, so if you take a lossy line, look at this. This is the standing wave pattern and it is reducing continuously. Okay, so we formulated an expression for the standing wave voltage, isn't it? Now let us move further, and then see, we have to find the maximum value of this expression and also the minimum value of this expression. Okay, so we can get by mathematical manipulation what is Vmax equation and what is Vmin equation. Okay, and then you can get the magnitudes of Vmax and Vmin by differentiating the above equation with respect to beta z and equating to 0. Okay, so Vmax points happen at the beta z equal to n into pi, where n equal to 0 plus or minus 1 plus or minus 2, etc. Okay, so the distance between consecutive, that is the adjacent maxima or adjacent minima, is lambda by 2. So how did we get that? See, this is beta z equal to n pi. You know beta is always equal to 2 pi by lambda, and if you substitute you get n lambda by 2, substituting n equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. So you get lambda by 2, 1 lambda by 2, 2 lambda by 2, like that. Okay, so this is Vmax and Vmin. Now why we are discussing this is, Vmax and Vmin are actually components of this standing wave, isn't it? So we have to define what a standing wave ratio is, for which we need the values of Vmax and Vmin. Fine. So just now I told you, whenever two waves have equal magnitude, it's a highly reflected signal. So magnitude of reflection coefficient is 1 and the wave is a pure standing wave. When there is no reflection, magnitude of reflection coefficient is 0 and the line is called a flat line. Please remember this. These terminology may come up in your problems sometime. Okay, see, standing wave ratio now is defined as maximum voltage divided by minimum voltage, or maximum current by minimum current. So you can have voltage standing wave ratio, which is VSWR. Okay, for short, it's an acronym, or ISWR, which is a current standing wave ratio, Imax by Imin. And these two parallel bars, they refer to magnitude, because both these are complex quantities, isn't it? So we take only their magnitudes. So from the equations of Vmax and Vmin, if you take the ratio, you get this. And what is tau here? It is the reflection coefficient. This rho is the standing wave ratio, tau is the reflection coefficient, and both are related like this. This is a very, very important relationship as far as the design of transmission lines are considered. Given rho, you can find tau and vice versa. Fine. Magnitude of tau only you can find, not phase angle. But if you are given magnitude of tau, you can find the standing wave ratio. Fine. So since standing wave ratio is a ratio of magnitudes, it's only a number. Okay, it doesn't have any unit. It is not a complex value. The individual components of Vmax and Vmin are complex, but this is only real because it is the ratio of only magnitudes. Fine. So please go through this and make a note of all the formulae. Now as such, what will be the minimum and maximum value of rho? Okay. See, let us start with the value of tau. What will be the maximum value of tau? 1, right? So 1 plus 1 is 2 here. 1 minus 1 will be 0. What will be 2 by 0? Anything by 0 is infinity, right? And when will a line have tau equal to 1? When it is a highly reflective wave line, right? So a highly reflective line will have infinite standing wave ratio. Understand? And when will a line be a flat line? When the value of tau is 0. When it is 0, what is this? 1 plus 0 by 1 minus 0 is nothing but 1. So the minimum value of rho or the standing wave ratio is 1. Whenever for any line, if SWR is equal to 1 VSWR, then it is called a flat line. That is no reflection line, ideal line. Okay. So in the design of transmission lines, our objective should be to bring rho value as close to 1 as possible. Okay, so next you will be designing many microwave transmission lines or two wire lines, coaxial lines in the system design, communication system design. So what should be your objective? Your objective is to keep the reflection value to as low as possible, by which you can bring the value of rho as close to 1 as possible, unity. Fine. So this should be your objective. And how to achieve this objective is what we are going to look at in our last lecture. Okay. So wherein we are going to see the impedance matching concepts and then the graphical solution to impedance matching. Fine. So again, a small example, which is again taken from the textbook. Straight away, you see, given the value of tau, you can calculate the value of rho, or given the value of two impedances, ZL and Z0, you can calculate both tau and rho. Okay. 2.21 is the value. Is it a flat line? Definitely not, because its value is far greater than 1. So it is a reflective line, which is also seen from the value of the reflection coefficient. If it's a flat line, this value should become 0, isn't it? So you see that this is a highly reflective line. Fine. So like this, you can solve simple problems by using the simple equations what are given in this lecture. Okay. So please remember the three important parameters for system design, transmission line design in particular. Fine. Thank you.